Sarah Duclin, have you ever been in a close personal relationship with Mr. Maguire?
I would like to say at the outset that Mr. Maguire was a colleague of 15 years. He was someone that I trusted. He was a trusted colleague.
Ms. Berejiklian, you should answer the question.
I am answering the question.
You should answer it directly.
And that developed into a close personal relationship.
The Premier's secret boyfriend.
It was something that you and Mr. Maguire sought to keep private?
Well, it was, yes. I'm a very private person and I didn't feel the relationship had sufficient substance for it to be made public.
But apparently there was substance enough to keep things going on the down low for years, the relationship stretching back to 2015.
Are you still in a close personal relationship with Mr. Maguire?
Obviously, a few months ago when I was asked to support this inquiry, it became apparent to me that I should have absolutely no contact anymore with that individual, and I ceased all contact.
It's not you, it's ICAC, who, by the way, were tapping our political paramour's phone calls, including this one.
He said words to the following effect, "You will always be my numero uno." Remember hearing that on the call that I played you on the
I do
position?
Remember, yep.
What did you mean by him always being your numero uno?
I think what I would have meant that there is that in my personal life I placed importance on how I felt about him.
It's awkward stuff, but it's also deadly serious because at the same time the Premier was calling Darryl Maguire her numero uno, he was allegedly misusing his office for personal benefit. A former MP for Wagga Wagga forced to quit Parliament in 2018 over dodgy deals with a Chinese developer.
I would never, ever turn a blind eye from any responsibility I had to disclose any wrongdoing that I saw.
But in another taped phone call, the Premier told her boyfriend...
I don't need to know about that bit.
..when the pair discussed one of his business deals.
I deny the proposition that I turned a blind eye, is I think what you're saying.
Some say Berejiklian's future is now untenable.
Gladys Berejiklian has no choice but to resign.
But for now, the Premier is digging in.
Never ever have I done anything but what is the highest standard of integrity. And where I have failed is in my personal life.
Battered, but not backing down.
I will call it a personal nightmare. You cannot appreciate for someone who's very private, for someone who is very by the book, for someone who put her trust in someone she thought she could trust. I can't tell you what it's done to me personally. It's been devastating.
Well, Sam Maiden has been watching this unfold, popcorn in hand, like the rest of us today, and she joins us now. Sam, talk about the press conference today. Gladys kind of took it from a corruption inquiry into a relationship breakdown. Do you think perhaps she won some people over today with that press conference?
Well, presumably that's what she's trying to do, but I think the problem for her argument that this was a personal relationship that was somehow unrelated to her conduct as Premier is why did this bloke keep ringing her up and talking to her about these business deals? And for me, the really damaging part of the phone calls that were played today was not the revelation that she referred to this individual as her numero uno, but her claim, her suggestion to him, I don't need to know about that bit. So he's basically saying, I'm about to make this deal that's going to help me pay off my debts, which may or may not help me pay the divorce settlement with my wife. And she's saying, well, don't tell me about that bit. Now, her evidence to the inquiry is that that wasn't suggesting to him that he should keep her in the dark because it might be a problem for her, that she was bored or she wasn't listening, but that wasn't really the way it sounded on the tapes.
Sam, not surprisingly, given it's New South Wales politics, there are people within the Liberal Party who want to use this to drag Gladys Berejiklian down and get her to resign. Can she hang on?
Well, I wouldn't have thought so in the longer term. I think this is going to be a problem for her if she was going to run to another election, because I think it's really left people scratching their head about whether they know this woman. Now, there are all sorts of unfortunate, clichés, I suppose, that fall out of people's mouths and heads when it comes to women and politics and, in this case, romance. But the bottom line is she is someone that has appeared to the world as a sort of Joan of Arc figure, this sort of virginal character. There's no bloke in sight. Now it turns out there was a bloke and he seems to be a bit of a goose. And I think that that's really got people worrying about her judgment. She didn't tell her friends, she didn't tell her family, she didn't tell her colleagues. And she's running this guy out of Parliament in 2018, demanding, holding press conferences saying he should resign, and not saying to voters or her colleagues, oh, by the way, I've got a relationship with him. Now, I'm still a little bit confused about what the nature of that relationship was. She described it as close and personal. She also says he wasn't, didn't have the status of describing him as a boyfriend. There's some sort of suggestion that she said the relationship wasn't intimate. She seems to be saying it was friends without financial benefits. But whatever the truth of the exact nature of the relationship, I think it's really shook people's view of who they thought Gladys Berejiklian was or is.
Gladys Berejiklian, though, Sam, this year has been a very strong leader for New South Wales. She's dealt with the pandemic with aplomb. She's, you know, she's balanced the economy and the health crisis. Does that win her any brownie points here?
Oh, of course it does. I mean, look, she's a woman to be admired. I think that people think that she has done an effective job post the Ruby Princess, of course, to actually get on top of the COVID-19 situation. It is just that this does raise a lot of questions, I suppose, in people's heads. Now, Andrew Constance came out before her press conference today and said she's, you know, worked her socks off. No one's worked harder than her. She's got a heart of gold, and he described, you know, a personal relationship as a human need. Well, I think we can all agree on that to some extent, but, you know, there's a lot of, you know, detail in those phone calls that I think really does have you wondering if it was a personal relationship, why does he keep ringing her up telling her about his business deals? What did he want?
What I don't quite get, Sam, is why did she break off the relationship at the point that she would be required at ICAC? I don't understand that. Like, that sounds to me like she's saying, oh, it was fine until ICAC got involved, and then suddenly all that conduct that is actually the subject of the inquiry, suddenly that's, like, that was never a problem? So it's only when ICAC appears that it's suddenly is? I don't get this.
Yeah, and don't forget, I mean, he'd been the subject of some interest at ICAC way back in 2018, right? There'd been taped phone calls way back in 2018. So presumably for a couple of years she's had it in the back of her head that maybe some of her phone calls with this individual had been taped. But, you know, I think the bottom line is that there's something unclear about the ebb and flow of this relationship. So I'm not clear whether towards the end she was maintaining contact with him because she was a friend or she was worried about him or that they're still in a relationship. She describes it as a close personal relationship, but she says she didn't break off contact essentially until she went into private hearings with ICAC. Mm-hmm. So that tells me that either she, you know, really wanted to look after him as a mate or she kind of thought that no one would find out.
Mm-hmm. All right, Sam, well, we'll watch and see as things unfold. Thanks so much for your time tonight.
Thank you.
Can 2020 deliver any more shocks? I mean, if I woke up this morning and someone said, oh, we're going to find out Gladys Berejiklian's had a boyfriend for 5 years, has been ringing her up, asking her about financial matters, I mean, I just can't believe it. I reckon she won a few fans, though, after that media conference today, Carrie. What do you think as a woman? I think a lot of women would have looked at that and had great sympathy for Gladys today.
No, there was a lot about the whole thing today. I was surprised even about the tapping of the phones. Mm. I didn't even realise that that would have been something that would have been happening to her the whole time. I mean, I don't know. I think there's a lot of murky area around all of it. I feel like we don't have a true picture. And
but
I'm
do
not
you think
sure
people
just a press
buy,
conference.
So they buy the bait and switch?
I mean, of course you can go, I understand, I've been with someone before, I couldn't trust, you know, as a woman. But as a human, you know, I don't know. I don't think you get a leave pass because you talk about a relationship breakdown in the middle of an ICAC thing. Do you know what I mean?
No, I do know what you mean.
Yes.
And I appreciate you speaking for all women with your perspective.
Well, I think it was pricey. It was
pricey feminine perspective.
Please.
The picture.
We've got to take a break.